Recorded. So clearly this is my system, and on this system there is gravity force, that is external force. Yes or no? I'm saying that even if gravity is there just before collision, if their velocities are v1 and v2, and just after the collision if their velocities are v1 dash and v2 dash, just before and after I'm telling you, okay? Because gravity is non-impulsive, so suddenly it cannot change momentum. So even if gravity is acting, I can conserve momentum. So I can write m1 v1 minus m2 v2. This is the initial momentum, okay, opposite direction momentums, is equal to m1 v1 dash minus m2 v2 dash. So this is, these velocities are v1 and v2 just before collision, okay? And V1 dash and V2 dash just after collision. Okay, this you need to be taking care of, because even if gravity is non-impulsive force, if you give it some time, gravity can change the momentum. For example, you cannot conserve momentum 2 hours before and 2 hours after, because gravity has good 4 hours to change the momentum. But if you conserve momentum just before and after collision, because gravity is non-impulsive, gravity can't change the momentum suddenly. All of you understood that you can conserve momentum even if there is an external force of spring or gravity. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You can conserve momentum just before and after, okay? That you need to be taking care of. But here are these three forces. These three forces can be impulsive, okay? They can be impulsive. They can suddenly change the momentum. They have a potential to suddenly change the momentum. So you need to be careful when these three forces are there as an impulsive force, okay? So let us analyze how can we deal with a scenario when there is an impulsive force, okay?
V2 minus V2 dash by V1 minus V1 dash will be a constant for two given masses.
Why?
Because, sir, like if you rearrange to take M1 and M2 out and if you divide, you get M1 by M2 is V2 minus V2 dash by V1 minus V1 dash. And M1 by M2 is a constant.
So that is a coefficient of restitution only, right?
Okay, yeah. Okay, yeah, yeah.
In M1, you can take M1 con. So you are rearranging the terms only. So that is fine. Okay.
Yeah.
So, but then that's a good observation. So. Okay. Fine. Let's see how the impulsive forces are being taken care of. So first we need to quantify what is impulse. Okay. Impulse, in words we know, it is sudden change in momentum. So we quantify the impulse as if it is just change in momentum only. Impulse is change in momentum. Okay, the SI unit of impulse is kg meter per second. It is mass into velocity. So we quantify impulse as change in momentum only, and there is a letter associated with it. It is called J. So J is a momentum. Okay, it is sudden change in momentum. J is equal to change in momentum. Now, suppose collision is happening between M1 and M2. There is an M2 as well. Now, because of the collision, there will be a normal reaction, and that will be impulsive. Sudden force, sudden large amount of force will be there, and there will be equal and opposite force. So this will be F and this is also F. Okay. They are in opposite direction. So if you write in a vector form, so it will be F and that will be minus F. Fine. So I can say that F is equal to rate of change of momentum of mass 1. Okay. Like this, you can write in the vector form. So rate of change of momentum, which is equal to F. So change in momentum of the first mass become equal to f dt. Okay, so when you integrate, again and again integration is coming. So you need to be comfortable with integration. So integration of delta P1 is change in momentum of the first mass. This is integral f dt. So right hand, left hand side becomes change in momentum. So right hand side should be impulse. So integral of f dt is my impulse. Okay, fine. So on this, the direction of impulse is that one. On that, impulse is this way. Fine. And I know that minus j vector impulse is on the second mass. This should be equal to change in momentum of the second one. Okay. So when I add these two boxed equations, if I add it up, j and j will get cancelled away. So I'll get change in momentum of the first plus change in momentum of second is zero. Now this has to be there because there is no external force. Okay, but then at times there is an impulsive external force. So when you add the two equations, it doesn't become zero. Okay, so we'll see that in numericals how such cases are taken care of. All of you understood about impulse? Any doubt? Okay, let's take a quick numerical on this. I think there'll be a little bit of hesitation in terms of solving numericals on this topic. Let's quickly take a numerical. I'm taking slightly tricky question, okay? So that we can learn multiple things in the same question. You just try it out. Suppose a ball is coming and when it is about to hit the floor, when it is about to hit the floor, its velocity is u and this angle is 45 degree, or let's keep it theta only, this is theta. Okay. A ball of mass m is coming like this. This is angle theta. Okay. Coefficient of restitution for this collision is e. Okay. This is floor. Of course, floor doesn't move. Floor will remain fixed. Coefficient of restitution is e. And the coefficient of friction is mu. Okay. This is mu. We need to find out the velocity of this mass immediately after collision. Just before the collision, its velocity is u at an angle theta with the vertical. Okay, try doing this, all of you. Just attempt it. You may or may not get it, but attempt it so that when I tell you, you will be able to relate it properly. Shushant says, I can't hear. I hope all of you are able to hear me.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Shushant, rejoin. Yes, sir. Rejoin, Shushant. Oh, now Shushant, no. Shashank it is. Shashank Ayyar. Let me know once you are done attempting the question. It's okay if you not get it.
Sir, is it minus EU?
Minus EU. Okay.
Yes, sir. And the angle will be, the tan theta will be mg by mu mg. Will be 1 by mu.
Okay. Who is this? Name?
Sir, Tripan.
Oh, Tripan. Okay. Others? Tripan, that is not correct actually. But then at least you attempted. Others, please attempt quickly. Okay, I'll start solving in couple of seconds. Alright, so I'll solve it now. See, this mass when it collides with the floor, what are the forces acting on it? There will be normal reaction. See, this is one of its kinds numerical. So first time when you do this numerical, nobody get it right. Okay, but then you need to pay attention, because once you see this solution, you should be able to solve all the similar kind of numericals. There will be mg force, okay, and also there will be a frictional force, okay, which is mu times normal reaction. Okay, I am assuming that maximum friction force is being exerted. Okay, that is one assumption I am making. Any doubt in this free body diagram?
Sir.
Okay, this is clear. Now tell me, which are the non-impulsive forces? Is mg impulsive? No. Normal reaction? Impulsive. What about friction? Is this impulsive?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
See, if normal reaction is impulsive, mu times normal reaction is also impulsive. Simple, right? Normal is, if n is infinity, mu times n is also infinity. Okay. Yes. So only impulsive forces are normal reaction and mu times n. So I can say that integral n dt, this is impulse along y direction. Okay. And mu times normal reaction into dt. This is friction force. This is the impulse along the minus of that is impulse along the x-axis, because I am assuming this direction to be positive and that upward direction to be positive, x and y. All of you understood this? I am ignoring mg because mg cannot suddenly change the momentum. Getting it? I am just integrating the time for which it is in contact with the surface. It immediately loses the contact. Any doubt? Is this clear? Okay, good. So, impulse in the y direction should be equal to change in the momentum along the y direction. And impulse in the x direction should be equal to change in the momentum in x direction. Ball, sir, but the ball strikes the floor at an angle. Yes, Anjali, that is correct. Perfectly correct. We'll take care of that. Okay, we'll take components. We'll take component of, just like we have taken component of impulse. This is vertical impulse, horizontal impulse. Similarly, we'll take the component of momentum. So that is why I am writing momentum along y direction and momentum along x direction. Clear? So change in momentum along y direction is what? Assume that after collision, assume that it is going with velocity v and at an angle of phi. Okay, then change in momentum along y direction is mass times v cos phi. This is the final momentum along y direction. Okay, and initial momentum along y direction is how much? Quickly tell me. How much is initial momentum?
Mu cos theta.
Mu cos theta, sir.
No, that is wrong. Minus of mu cos theta is correct. My change in the momentum along y direction is minus of minus mu cos theta. Okay, so this is the correct equation. So we have got integral of n dt is equal to mv cos phi plus mu cos theta. Okay, this is the first equation, and the second equation is minus of integral mu n dt. Change in momentum in x direction is what? Final momentum along x direction is m into v into sine of phi. Okay, minus initial momentum along x direction is what? Tell me quickly.
Mu sine theta.
Mu sine theta. Okay, now how to deal with these two equations? How to solve these? There is an integral sign also. So can someone tell me quickly what to do to solve these two equations? No one?
We can square right and add.
Okay, see here, this is mu, right? Mu is constant. So I can take it outside the integral. Are you getting it? So this is same as minus of mu times integral n dt. This term. Okay. So if I multiply minus mu to this, I can equate it to that. What I mean to say is that minus of mu mv cos of phi. See, I understand this is little too much of mathematics, but then pay attention, you will understand. It's a, like, once you do it properly, you will understand this. Lot of such questions are there, so we need to understand this. We can't ignore this. Have you understood this equation? This is my first equation. All of you understood?
Sir.
Okay, second equation is the coefficient of restitution equation. Coefficient of restitution is what? E, which is velocity of approach, magnitude of velocity of separation divided by magnitude of velocity of approach. Okay, now velocity of separation is what? Quickly tell me, separation velocity is, with what velocity the ball is separating?
V.
No, u, I mean, why you're taking
V cos theta.
V cos phi. See, separation and approach, please write it down, separation and approach should be seen along the normal. Okay, please write it down. Separation and approach should be seen along the normal. If you're not moving along normal, you're not coming closer or going far. You're just moving parallel to the surface. So it doesn't mean that you're approaching. Approach will only happen when you move along the normal. Okay. So velocity of separation is V cos phi. And velocity of, this is velocity of separation. And velocity of approach, we just need to take the magnitude. Okay. So that's why I'm ignoring the sign. Otherwise, there is a minus sign in the formula itself. V cos phi divided by U cos theta. Okay, so this is my second equation. So I have two variables, phi and V. So when I solve these two equations, I'll get the answer. Now, I'm not getting into how to solve these two equations. It may be difficult because I just made up a question. In the actual numerical, there will be values of theta and phi given such a way that you will be able to solve it easily. But the concept remains this only. Okay. Now, please go through it once and let me know if you have any doubts in this question.
Sir, could you repeat how you arrived at equation 1?
Okay. See, this is the impulse along the y-axis. I am ignoring mg because mg is not impulsive. It cannot suddenly change the momentum. And I know that impulse, see here we have derived, impulse is integral of f dt. Okay, force dt integral is change in momentum. So that is what I have written. Impulse along the y axis is integral of n dt. Okay. Which should be equal to change in the momentum along y-axis. Impulse along y-axis can only change momentum along y-axis. It cannot change momentum along x-axis. And impulse along x-axis is minus of mu n dt. Because I am taking that direction to be positive. So it becomes minus of mu n dt. This should be equal to change in momentum along x-axis. Now look at these right-hand sides. Mu is constant. So I can take it outside the integral. So it is minus of mu times integral n dt, which is nothing but this itself, integral n dt. So instead of integral n dt, I am substituting mv cos phi plus mu cos theta and I am getting first equation. Clear?
Yes.
Any other
so
doubt?
What are the limits you have put? See, so what are the limits you have put for the integration?
Okay, limit will be such that it should denote time for which the force is being applied. Okay, and we are assuming that the force is applied for a very, very small period, and limit actually doesn't matter. I have not used the limits to integrate. I've just casually written at 0 to tau. I don't know what is tau. I have never integrated it. I just wrote it for the representation sake. Any other doubt?
Yes.
Any other doubts? Quickly tell me. Okay. No doubts. Fine. So let us start solving the numericals from the entire chapter. The chapter is over now. Okay. When I say chapter is over, the theory is over. Okay. The theory constitutes just 2 to 3% of the chapter. 97 to 98% is only problem practice. Okay, so we can't solve all kinds of questions in the class itself. So 70 to 80% of your preparation happens on what you do at home. So I'm just showing you few type of numericals. So once the class gets over, please solve at least 100 questions of work power energy. Then you can say that I am done. So if you practice now, you will have to only solve 100 questions to be comfortable. But later on, when you forget the concepts are not very fresh, then you may have to solve, instead of 100, you have to solve 200 questions then. Okay. So do yourself a favor and practice in this week itself, 100 questions. Anyways, solve this question, which you can see on your screen. All of you, attempt this one. I have taken simple questions only, mains level. I have not gone up to advanced level. Okay, so this can be useful for your CET, mains and NEET, all three. Full work power energy is there. Yes, Aditya, the syllabus was till whatever we have done in work power energy, and luckily or unluckily we have done the entire chapter now, so full thing is coming.
Can be taken as M now, sir.
If something is not given, assume it to be M, L, whatever you want to assume. If the answer is independent of that, it automatically gets cancelled away.
Is the floor frictionless, sir?
Floor frictionless, yes. It is not given here. So we'll assume floor to be frictionless.
Okay.
That's a good question.
Sir, is the answer C, 3/4?
Okay, let I'll solve it. Others, you're getting any answer? Will the ball leave the floor with the same angle after collision? Anjali, that will happen if the collision is elastic. But here, collision is not elastic. C, coefficient of restitution is not 1. Okay. So this is 45 degrees and this is theta, which we don't know. Let's say mass is m. Okay, now tell me, coefficient of restitution is half given. So if initial velocity is u and final velocity is v, how can you write half as equal to? This is velocity of separation divided by velocity of approach, right? Magnitude of that. So velocity of separation is how much?
V cos theta.
V cos theta divided by velocity of approach is u cos 45. Right. So this is the first equation. What will be second equation? What do you think?
Sir, u sin 45 is equal to v cos v sin theta.
Okay.
Since there's no horizontal force.
Right. So you can see that there is no horizontal impulse. Friction is absent. So no horizontal impulse. This implies that momentum doesn't change. Momentum does not change in the horizontal direction. Okay, so initial momentum mu sine 45. This is initial momentum. This should be equal to somebody's background noise is coming. Please mute it. This is the initial momentum in the horizontal direction just before the collision. This should be equal to the final momentum in the horizontal direction just after the collision. So mv sine theta. Okay, so you can see that mass gets cancelled away from here as well. So v sine theta is equal to u sine 45. So u root 2. This is my second equation. And from the first equation, you'll get v cos theta Netra, you need to mute yourself. Okay, so v cos theta is equal to u cos 45 into half. So I'll get u divided by 2 root 2. Okay, this is my first equation. Okay, so how do I get v from first and second equation? What should I do now?
Square and add.
Square and add, theta is gone. Okay, so when you square and add, you'll get v square sine square theta plus cos square theta, which is 1. So this is equal to u square by 2 plus u square by 4 into 2, 8. Okay, so you'll get v square is equal to this is how much? 10 by 16 u square. So you'll have 5 by 8 u square. So if you multiply half and m both sides, you'll get half m v square is equal to 5 by 8 times half m u square. So you can see that the final kinetic energy, half mv square, is 5 by 8 times the initial kinetic energy. Okay. Anyone got option A in this problem? Anybody was able to solve it?
Sir, but kinetic energy.
Sir, isn't it lost?
Yeah. Yes, sir. So it should be 1 minus 5 by 8,
no? Oh, yeah. I'm sorry about it. I did some silly error here. So this is the final kinetic energy is 5 by 8. So loss is 1 minus 5 by 8. So 3 by 8. Sorry about that. Okay, so loss is 1 minus 5 by 8 times the initial kinetic energy. So that is 3/8. Okay. Anybody got 3/8? No one was able to solve it. Okay.
No, sir.
Okay. But have you understood this? Any doubts here? Okay. Yes.
No, sir.
Okay. Fine. Let's go to the next one. This. Akshit, Rochir Parekh, they are also here from HSR batch. You also can speak up. You don't need to be muted all the time.
Sir, is your option C, sir?
Okay. Who is this?
Richard.
Okay. Others?
Sir, option C, sir. 2/5 meter per second.
Who?
Option C, 2/5 towards the right.
Okay. Who is this?
Shankin, sir.
Shankin. Okay, it's hard for me to remember your names looking at your faces, so remembering your names just by hearing your voice is even more difficult.
Sir, option C.
Option C. So three people have got the option C. Anybody else? So,
CC.
Wait, sir, one.
See, clearly we have to use conservation of momentum here in the horizontal direction. And there are three masses. So, their initial momentum is zero, right? Everything was at rest. So, initial momentum is zero. So total final momentum should also be zero. Okay, I'll solve it now. So initial momentum is zero. So final momentum should also be zero. So I have to take one direction to be positive. So I'm taking that direction to be positive. Okay, the right side. So zero should be equal to 80 into 1. Okay, then momentum of 60 kg person is in opposite direction. So that should be taken negative. So minus of 60 into 2. And the plank has mass 100. So I'll take plus 100 into V. I don't know which direction the plank will move, so I am taking at plus 100 into V. If that direction is not correct, V will come out to be negative. So nothing to be worrying about. 0, 0, 0. So 10 of V will be equal to 12 minus 8, that is 4. So V will come out to be 4 by 10 meter per second, which is 2 by 5 meter per second. So option C is correct. Okay, a simple question on conservation of momentum. Okay, any doubts?
No, sir.
Okay. I'm going to the next question now. This one. First, tell me when the maximum compression will happen. What is the condition for maximum compression to happen?
M1 will compress.
M1 will compress the spring, but it will keep on compressing. So, what will be the condition for which the compression in the spring is maximum? At that position,
what will happen? Velocity of separation is zero.
Correct. So both will move in the same velocity. Both will move in the same velocity. So that is the condition for the maximum compression. Okay. The velocity of M1 will decrease and of M2 will increase. Till the velocity of M1 is more than velocity of M2, spring will keep on compressing. As soon as the velocity of M1 equals to the velocity of M2, the spring will stop compressing. And that is the maximum compression. So you can conserve the momentum and you can conserve the energy also. You can use work energy theorem. Anyone? Anjali says it is 5. Others? Okay, I'll solve it now or should I wait? Quickly tell me. Tirpan, should I wait?
Yes, sir, 1 minute.
Okay, meanwhile, I'll just write down the equations that will be used here. First equation is conservation of momentum. So between the points before the collision and when the compression in the spring is maximum. So initial momentum is mass m1, which is 2 kg, is moving with 10 meter per second. So 2 into 10 is the initial momentum of m1 plus initial momentum of m2 is 5 kg of m2, 5 into 3. This should be equal to when the both of them starts moving with the same velocity, let's say velocity is v. So 2 into v plus 5 into v. So 2 plus 5 into v. All of you got this one? This relation?
Yes, sir.
12 plus 15, 27 by 7 meter per second. This is the velocity with which both of them will move at the time when the compression in the spring is maximum. Now I can use work energy theorem. Okay, I can use work energy theorem here. W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay. K1 is half into 2 into 10 square, half mv square for mass 1 plus half m into v square. M is 5.
Sir, it's v equals 35 by 7.
Right? The equation 1 is 5 meter per second.
20 plus 15. 37.
So 35 by 7.
Oh, 35 by 7. Okay, so this is 5 meter per second.
5 meter per second.
Right. So K1 is this. U1 is what? Initial potential energy is 0. Okay. K2 is equal to half into total mass, which is m1 plus m2, 5 plus 2, 7. 7 into 5 square. So as if it is moving with the same velocity, so I directly write both of them together. Or you can write half into 2 into 5 square plus half into 5 into 5 square. So this will only come. U2 is equal to half kx square. W is 0. So when you solve it, the value of x is the answer. Can you quickly get the answer? How much it is? In this entire chapter, you just have two things to take care of: conservation of momentum and work energy theorem. Nothing else you have to do. There should not be any confusion. Previous equation. Are you talking about the momentum equation? Anjali, that is momentum equation you want to... See, the first one is conservation of momentum. Okay. So, I am conserving the momentum before the collision and when the compression in the spring is maximum. So, I have got the velocity when the compression in the spring is maximum, which comes out to be 5 meter per second. Condition for maximum compression is that both the mass move with the same velocity. Okay. Just 1 second. Hello. Okay, and the work energy theorem, in the work energy theorem, I am applying the work energy theorem again between the same two points. Okay, so initial kinetic energy, you know, how I have written initial kinetic energy, which is half m1 v1 square plus half m2 v2 square. So that is half 2 into 10 square plus half 5 into 3 square. Okay. And initial potential energy is 0 because spring is not compressed. And also everything is happening on the horizontal line. So even the gravitational potential energy is 0. Fine. And finally, spring get compressed. So the potential energy is half kx square. Okay, and the kinetic energy is the final kinetic energy, which is half mv square plus half m2 v2 square. So that is what half 7 into 5 square is. And work done is 0 because there is no other force other than for which you have considered potential energy, which is doing work. Is it clear now, all of you? Okay. Let's go to the next question now. This one.
So was the previous answer 25 centimeter?
See, answer I did not store, but exactly how what we have done, it is just solving the equations now remaining. Okay, focus on this question now. I'll send you the final answers later. You can answer one by one. 13th question you can answer first.
Sure, option D.
Okay, others?
Yes, option D.
Those who think they have got 13th, move on to the next one. Others? What is the answer for 13?
14 is A.
See, you can keep on solving 14 and 15. I am asking about 13 only. Till I ask 14, please don't answer 14th one before I ask. Others, did you get the 13th question? Okay, so for the 13th question, we need to apply the work energy theorem. W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay, so W is 0, K1 is 0, and let's say ground is my zero potential energy, so U2 is 0. U1 is mgh and K2 is half mv square. So v is equal to under root 2gh, which is none of these. Okay, wait, I'm sorry. B is movable, right? Even B can move. Okay, I have assumed that B is fixed. Okay. So that is not correct. I think most of you might have assumed B to be fixed. Those who got D answer, have you assumed wedge B to be fixed?
Yes, sir.
That is wrong then. Okay, that's not correct. B can move. Block A is placed on wedge B. Block and two wedges are same mass M. So why mass is given? Because even wedge can move. Okay, so when this is coming down, wedge is sliding backwards like that. Understood? So please solve 13th question again, all of you. The hint is, let me give you a hint. When the mass comes to the bottommost point, its velocity is horizontal and the velocity of this mass is also horizontal. Okay, horizontally there is no net force on these wedge and mass together, so you can conserve the momentum in the horizontal direction and then you can use work energy theorem. Same two things you have to use.
So then won't the answer remain the same?
No. Please attempt 13th again. Wedge B and C are not fixed together, Abhishek. B is a independent wedge and C is independent wedge. Okay. Okay, so let us first write conservation of momentum. Conservation of momentum equation. Initial momentum along the horizontal direction is 0. This should be equal to final momentum. So let's say velocity of the mass M is V1 and velocity of the wedge. Velocity of the wedge is V2. Velocity of the mass is V1. Okay. So 0 should be equal to M into V1 minus wedge's mass is also M. So M into V2. So from here you get V1 is equal to V2. Conservation of momentum. Clear all of you how we write conservation of momentum?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now conservation of energy equation. Orange one. conservation of energy is this. Okay, so the value of, I'll write it again actually. See, the value of K1 is 0, okay, U1 is MGH, K2 is half M into V1 square plus half M into V2 square, okay, so you can write it as M into V1 square plus half M into V2 square. Now, since V1 is equal to V2, these two will add up to give you M into V1 square only. And V2 is 0, U2 is 0, W is 0. So when you solve it, you'll get V1 is equal to root of GH. So option A is correct. Please go through this solution again and let me know if you have any doubts for the 13th question. First, I have conserved the momentum in the horizontal direction. Okay, that is little counterintuitive because you never conserve momentum in such kind of scenarios, but these scenarios do exist. Okay, good to know that because you don't want to know this at the time of exam, so you should know it beforehand. So first is conservation of momentum, second is conservation of energy. And you don't have anything else to use in this entire chapter. Is it clear to all of you how we have done 13th?
Yes, sir.
They shunk in, right?
No, sir. Netra.
Netra. Oh, sorry. Okay. So, no doubts. So let's solve 14th now. Question number 14. A question number 14 also can be solved in a very similar manner.
Sir, when the block A comes to rest on C, that time C can be moving towards the right, no sir?
Okay, what is the condition for block A to reach the maximum height on C? Tell me.
Potential energy is 0. Kinetic energy is 0.
Kinetic energy is 0?
Kinetic energy of A.
No. It could be moving with the block C, na? Block C is going horizontally, so it could be moving with it. The condition for the maximum height is that velocity in vertical direction becomes 0. We have done in projectile motion also. We keep on using it. Okay. So velocity along Y direction is 0. So only velocity remain should be along X axis. That is the condition. Getting it? So when you conserve momentum in the horizontal direction, the horizontal component of the velocity which you use in the conservation of momentum is actually the total velocity itself at the maximum height. Is it clear? Okay, I'll explain it again. Suppose this is the maximum height. Suppose this is the maximum height up to which mass can move. It cannot move above this point. Okay. Then only velocity possible should be horizontal. Vertical direction velocity, this direction, velocity along y direction should be equal to 0. This is what I am saying. Velocity along x direction can be there, and which will be equal to velocity of the wedge itself. Wedge is also moving horizontally. So horizontally it will move with the wedge, but vertically it will stop moving if that is a maximum height. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So basically what I am saying is that its horizontal component of velocity is its total velocity. Okay. Now I can conserve momentum in the horizontal direction. From this point, when it is at the bottommost location, to the point where it is at a maximum height, I can conserve the momentum. How can I conserve momentum? Initial momentum is m into v1, which is nothing but m into root gh, which we have found out. This should be equal to the final momentum, m into velocity along the x direction for the m, plus wedge's velocity in the x direction, which is also vx only. Okay, so both the velocities are same along x direction for the wedge as well as for mass m, because both are going together. Okay, so at the highest point, velocity along x axis is root gh by 2. Okay, this is the velocity along x axis, and luckily this velocity along x axis is the total velocity of small m block as well as for the wedge. Wedge is anyway moving along horizontal direction only, it can't move vertically. Even for the mass also, this is the total velocity. So when you write kinetic energy, you don't need to worry about y component of velocity. When you write half mv square, that v could be vx itself, because vy is 0. Okay. So I can use work energy theorem, W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1 over here, and W is 0. When I write U2 to be equal to mgh, I'll get the value of h. That is what in the question they are asking. U1 is 0. It has started from ground. K1 is half m into v1 square, and k2, both block and the mass, both block and the wedge are moving together. So this is 2m into vx square. So when you solve it, you'll get the value of h. Can anyone solve and tell me what is the final answer? Anyone? No, Ronak, that doesn't come out as the answer. Option A would be correct if both the wedges are at rest. What happens is that some of the kinetic energy is gained by both the wedges. So they take away some energy. So it will not again climb back to the same height. It is h by 4. Yes, h by 4. If you solve these equations, you'll get h by 4. Okay? H by 4 is the answer. Tell me.
Sir, we can't write work energy theorem only for the block and solve it, sir.
Like, no, without, you just cannot. For the block taken. You cannot, because the normal reaction is doing work on the block. So that component will come in now. Okay?
Okay.
Because perpendicular direction also small m is moving along the wedge, because wedge is moving. So you don't want to find out the work done by normal reaction. So what you do is that you take both of them together. So then normal reaction becomes a conservative internal force. So work done by normal reaction is zero. Okay, so that's what. And you can see also that some energy is taken away by the wedge. So as if the block has donated some energy to the wedge. So you cannot conserve energy for mass m only, because some energy it has given to the wedge. Okay, let's go to the next question. We'll leave 15th one for the homework. Do this, 9th. We know that work done is integral of f dot dr. If f and dr are in the same or in the exactly opposite direction, integral f dot dr is simply equal to f into dr integral, or minus f into dr integral, then this is simply represented as area under f and r. Okay, so area of force and displacement curve is the work done, remember that. What is the answer?
There is it D, 20 joules.
20 joules. Others? Sudha, 20. Ruchir, yes, sir, 20. Ruchir was also saying 20. Ranganath, 20. Okay. I'll quickly attempt this one. Work,
yes, sir, 20.
Okay. Work done in displacing the body from x equal to 1 meter to x equal to 5 meters. So when I say area under the curve, I mean to say area between the x-axis, which is your displacement axis, and the curve. Okay, so I'm talking about this area. So from 1 to 5, you have this area, this one, this one, this, and that one. This work done is negative. So this area you have to subtract. Other areas you need to add. So I can say that this one block, as in one square, is of the area of 1 into 5. 5 is the area of one block. These are the three blocks. So 15 minus 5 becomes 10. Okay. And this is 15 minus 5, 10. And then this is approximately 5 only. This area plus that area, you can say this is one square area, which is 5. So 15 plus 5, 20, minus 5, 15 is the answer.
No, sir, it's 20 only.
Why?
Both the triangles are 10 each.
From 1 to 5, x from 1 to 5.
So, yeah, it's half.
What?
Both triangles together are 10.
Assuming from x from 1 to 5, not from 0 to 5.
X from 1 to 5, not 0.
No, no, it is, I think I'm correct here. See, these two triangles, this triangle and that triangle, this triangle occupies only, this triangle occupies less than 5 or not? This triangle is less than 5, okay? This is less than 5 and this will add up to it. You can add this smaller part over here and say that this plus this is full square, which is 5. Okay, so this entire thing is 5. 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 5, 20 minus 5, 15. So 15 is the answer. Two triangles are not 10, two squares are 10. Okay, so when you add two squares area, it is 10, not the two triangles area is 10, okay? And you can't find entire area. What they're asking you, area, the work done from 1 meter to 10 meters. So you need to find just area from 1 to 5, okay? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so be careful. This one. It's a simple application of work energy theorem. Okay, just write down work energy theorem, W is equal to U2 plus K2, all that, and substitute the values. Okay, step number one, write this and just put the values.
So, 11th answer is option D.
Okay, you continue going, continue solving the next one. I don't know the final answer. We'll talk about it. Others, have you attempted 11th? Do you know work done by the spring formula? Do you remember that? Work done by the spring is, anyone? Say it.
Half kx squared.
That is wrong. Half k x2, x1 square, sorry, minus half k x2 square. This is the work done by the spring from x1 compression or extension to x2 compression or extension. Okay. Now the natural length of the spring is 2r. Okay. And the other string is, okay, this is 1.5 times r. Now, how much spring is extended initially? Can you find out x1? How much it is?
R by 2.
How it is r by 2? This distance is what? The hypotenuse. This is how much?
5 r by 2.
This is under root of 2r square plus 3r by 2 whole square. So this will be 5r by 2. Natural length is 2r. So extension
is 2r. 5r by 2 minus 2r.
So natural length is 2r. So extension is 5r by 2 minus 2r. This will be r by 2. Okay. So and x2 is 0 because it comes to natural length. So x2 becomes 0. So work done by this spring is half k, which is 4 mg by r into r by 2. Okay. So you will get as mg
sir, into r by 2 whole squared.
Sir, r square by 4.
Oh, yeah. So MgR by 2. Okay. So you'll get option A. Yes, Aditya, that is correct. Good that you remember the formula. Now solve the 12th question. 12th question can be solved by applying work energy theorem. This is the work energy theorem.
Is it A 2 root JR?
Okay, others?
Sir, I got B. Sir, I got B.
D.
B, B, sir.
B, okay. Others?
Yes, sir.
I got A, sir.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me solve it now. So, when I apply work energy theorem, I am taking work done by the spring as the potential energy. So when I apply this equation, W is 0. Okay. Shaumik, don't sing.
Somic.
You want to sing? Let's have Somic. Somic, please sing now. Everybody, listen to Somic. Somic, come on.
Sir, that wasn't me, sir. Sorry, sir.
Okay. Fine. So W is 0. So U2 is the potential energy, right? So there are two kinds of potential energies here. We have potential energy due to gravitation and potential energy due to spring. So let's say that this is the horizontal line for which gravitational potential energy is 0. So finally, the gravitational potential energy is 0, but the spring potential energy is there. So U2 is half k into x square, which is, we have already found out the value of half k x square, which is mgr by 2. So I'll directly write that. I'll not calculate it again. So mgr by 2 is U2 plus k2. That is what I have to find out. What is the velocity? So half mv square minus U1 is what? When it is here at this location, the spring potential energy is, okay, sorry about this, at this location even spring is relaxed. So spring and gravitation, both potential energies are 0 in U2. But initially there is a spring potential energy which is half k x square, which is mgr by 2, as well as gravitation potential energy, which is mg into 3r by 2. So both the potential energies are initially itself. Finally, both potential energies are 0. Plus k1 is 0. Okay. Any doubt in this expression, all of you? Have you understood how we got this? Hello. Understood?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Sorry.
Okay. See, so I'll simplify this further. I'll get G into 2R. When you add these two, G into 2R is equal to V square by 2. So from here, you'll get V is equal to 2 under root GR. So option A is correct. Okay. Option A. Fine. I hope it is clear. Let us go to the next question. Or let us, should we take a small break? You guys want to take a break? Can take a 10 minutes break.
Yes, sir.
Okay, only one person wants break.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll take a break for 10 minutes. Right now it is 10:44. We will meet at 10:54. So this is your break time. Go and eat your breakfast. Okay. Bye-bye. We meet after 10 minutes.